With so many geographic barriers and such a diverse population, New Mexico presents unique challenges in a lot of areas in our everyday lives, including how information is shared. That makes the work of journalists across our state even more challenging. I got a chance to sit down with three independent journalists with three very different audiences to talk about how they reach their communities.
We've got Leota Harriman. She's the editor and publisher of The Independent in Edgewood. And I have a smile on my face because she can find room for one of our favorite people we have in the show. You might know who she is. I know you do, Leota. She's one of the wonderful writers for you. We've also got Ryan Lowery. He's a freelance journalist, often does work with the Las Vegas Optic, among other local and national outlets. He's also president of the local chapter of the Society for Professional Journalists. And we welcome back Peter Rice, who has been with us before. Very pleased to have him. He's the editor of Downtown Albuquerque News, a hyperlocal online news site covering, of course, downtown Albuquerque and surrounding areas. And thank you all for being here. I really, really appreciate it. Leota, let me start with you. You know, one of the things at our shop here at New Mexico PBS that really caught our eye was what you wrote on Facebook a few weeks ago about what you've had to deal with through the pandemic and other things. I wanted those start with The Independent. When did it start? Who does it serve? What's the area? Then we'll get into what you actually wrote and some of the challenges you're facing out there.
Okay. Mm-hmm. The Independent is a weekly community newspaper. We cover about 4,000 square miles in the center of New Mexico, eastern Bernalillo County, southern Santa Fe County, and all of Torrance County, and even a little bit of the periphery of that, it's warranted. We're a weekly print newspaper, at least we were until the end of January. Mm-hmm. You know, we cover town, we cover high school sports, we cover, you know, all the things, a few regional issues. We don't really get too deeply into regional issues because we haven't got to staff, frankly. Mm-hmm. It's been around since 1999. Mm-hmm. It was created in Tijeras by a guy named Wally Gordon. Mm-hmm. We had an employee buyout from him in 2010. And there were four of us initially, and I'm the last one, you know, still crazy enough to want to try and do this.
Bless you. Bless your heart. Interesting. What's the staff currently? Is it just you at this point, Leota? Or do you have
the staff currently is decimated. You know, I got COVID in at the end of January, was out for all of February. And, you know, we're a family business. And so I have my daughter and my son-in-law working for me, and they both had to, you know, take a job in a nutshell. So our staff is minimal currently.
If there was one challenge, I know the obvious answer is money here, but if there was one big challenge just keeping you from getting back to where you were before, what would it be? Is it finding quality reporters and employees? I mean, we got a good amount here. Is it finding the advertising? What's the biggest challenge you're facing right now?
The biggest challenge is probably finding the advertising.
Yeah.
You know, our bread and butter is really mom and pops, and they've been hit really hard by the pandemic as well. Mm-hmm. And so we've had throughout 2020 and 21, we had people saying, we can't advertise. We don't even know if we're going to be open next week.
Right.
As a person currently in that position, I have a lot more empathy for that now, because it's a real struggle when you don't know if you can make payroll, you don't know if you can buy your product, you don't know if you can do anything, let alone promote your business. So mm-hmm. I think that's probably the biggest is, you know, because the model of newspapers has been so heavily reliant on advertising.
Right.
If there's any glitch with the advertisers, the newspaper, you know, maybe a few steps down the road, but really feels that impact.
Hey, Peter Rice, when did you start Downtown Albuquerque News? What month, what year was that?
That was August of 2019.
Ah, how quickly good times go. I didn't realize it was that far back.
Yeah, so, a few things have happened.
That's right. Now, let folks know a little bit about your background, too. You didn't just pop out of the earth and start this publication. You've been in the news business for a while. So go ahead, tell us about your background as well.
Sure. Yeah, I've done some work for KUNM over the years and for the Albuquerque Tribune right before it went out of business there. Before that, I mean, I was a weird nerdy homeschooler, so I was doing community radio and right. fun things like that back when I was a teenager growing up in Olympia, Washington. So I hate to admit it, but I think I'm almost a veteran at this business, but
that's
probably
right.
means I'm
older. That's right. Why downtown Albuquerque as a news beat? I'm so curious.
Well, I live here, so that was an obvious answer. Because mm-hmm. So I kind of had a heads up on that. It was an advantage. I knew where everything was, more or less. And it, I think, from a journalistic perspective, it's easier to do a niche publication about an area that kind of has a coherent sense of itself. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, the river, I-25, I-40, those are all not just literal physical dividing lines, but they are major psychological dividing lines. And if you live on one side of those, you kind of think a certain way and orient right. towards certain things. And if you live on the other side, you think a different way and you orient toward different things. So it was a good little niche to mine there.
Mm-hmm. There is no lack of reporting on, you know, what you've been able to dig up. I honestly had no idea there was so much going on. I live down here too. And until your publication came out, I didn't realize there was so much going on around me, honestly. I'm curious what the feedback's been from downtown folks. Is this, how have you been received since 2019?
I'd say pretty well. I mean, it's, it is pretty well here and crickets everywhere else. Cause like I said, it is a downtown publication. Mm-hmm. And frankly, if you live in Knob Hill even or the North Valley, right. you probably don't care. But like, you're right, there is a lot going on down here. I was actually kind of worried at one point that maybe I would run out of news, but I'm having the opposite problem. There's all kinds of stuff going on. And part of that is just because it is the city center. There's a lot of redevelopment stuff happening all the time, seat of government, all that sort of thing. So there's plenty to do. In retrospect, I probably shouldn't have been worried.
Now, Leota, you mentioned a phenomenal square mile footage that you have to serve. That is unbelievable. I have to imagine that is a lot of disparate needs as well when it comes to news inside. Give us again the square miles you're dealing with here.
It's approximately 4,000 square miles. So if you can imagine a square that goes from, maybe Madrid over to Stanley, south down to Estancia Willard, back wow. west over to Mountain Air, and then back up through the, the Manzanos and the Sandias, and everything in the middle of that.
Wow.
It's hugely diverse. There's a bunch of it that's bedroom communities for Albuquerque. There's, area-wise, the majority of it is very rural, not mm-hmm. so much suburban, but actual, rural. I'm surprised that my chickens haven't made a big ruckus yet. there's a lot of poverty in some areas of it. Other areas of it are extremely affluent. It is all the way diverse.
When I picture my mind's eye how you just described that square, there's a whole lot of interesting stuff there. That is very interesting. And Peter, yeah. you're on the exact opposite. Again, we covered this, but you have a zone you described earlier. It ain't 4,000 miles square, that's for sure. But it is pretty deep. And that's the opposite. Like to my mind, I'm always saying, how does Peter keep up with the rotation that comes very quickly? It probably more quickly than any other part of the state of New Mexico, arguably, when you think about it. So your sources, do you have to really run this like a good old fashioned newspaper and cultivate a lot of relationships and have people feeding into you, things like that? Is that part of your work as well?
Yeah. And I mean, I'm fascinated by the comparison with the Independent and Edgewood, because it seems utterly absurd. And our business models are, almost polar opposites. But but in some ways, it's very similar, because I've long thought that small town papers did a better job of covering their constituents than big town papers. Mm-hmm. And I came to Albuquerque from a small town paper on the Oregon coast. And I'm pretty much for downtown Albuquerque News, all I did was copy that model, bring it into a purely digital age. So, you know, I don't have a printing press or anything like that, and plant it on what I think are 4 or 5 square miles in downtown Albuquerque. So 1 square mile for every 1,000 that Leona's got to deal with. But yeah, it really is, you know, in a small town paper, you can get to know everybody. You have a pretty close beat. You go to a lot of meetings. You go to a lot of coffees. And it really helps to live in the area. And you can walk around and notice story ideas, even when you're on your day off or something. Yeah. And you can really go deep in both a small town and a small part of a big town. And I think that really is the sort of atomic level of local journalism. Like when I was at the Tribune, covering a metro area, it did not feel like local journalism. Technically, it was. It certainly wasn't the New York Times. But you're kind of skimming above this massive metro area of, 700,000-800,000 people. And it is extremely difficult to impossible to really get down into the nitty gritty of things to the point where you can report stories from the ground up. In other words, you can, for what Leona does, I imagine, for what I do, you can just notice things before the officials are talking about them. Stuff happens at a neighborhood association meeting, or you meet someone on the street, or you just walk by and you notice something's a little different. That becomes the story that you then bring the higher ups in. When I was working at a metro paper, it was just the opposite. We didn't have time to get down into the nitty gritty of the beat. And so we were doing this top down journalism that I really don't think rang as true as what I do today and what I did at a small town paper in Oregon. So, Leona, we're not so different, you and I, as the movie villains like to say.
Ryan, let me ask you from the Las Vegas optic, of course. Ribero, New Mexico is a lot different than downtown Albuquerque. And I'm curious about your geographic imprint for the Las Vegas optic. First of all, how far do you guys cover?
Officially San Miguel County and Mora counties. It's not quite, I still don't think it's as big as Leota's coverage area, but we're talking very focused on Las Vegas, but yeah, down into Pecos, up into rural Mora, sometimes beyond if there's something that connects a story to either of those counties. Mm-hmm. But those are two very big counties, very rural counties. So you have Las Vegas, which is only something like 7 square miles as a city, about 16,000 people. And then you have a lot of rural area that we also do cover. There is a definite difference in what's covered in the rural area versus in Las Vegas proper. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, a lot of those things are linked, particularly with government coverage and those kinds of things.
I appreciate that you sit with multiple editors, you sit with multiple publishers, you have a different perspective on these things. Where is independent journalism in New Mexico at this point in your view?
I think it's in a better place than probably a lot of people suspect or think of it as. Journalism worldwide it's tough right now. Constantly under attack, and we've been labeled the enemy of the people by former leaders and things like that. That doesn't help. So it's, it's an industry that's definitely been beaten up, and as journalists, I think many of us feel beaten up. But New Mexico has a fantastic, close-knit journalism community. There are so many talented and dedicated journalists here. I think that strengthens all of journalism in terms of independent journalism. Mm-hmm. It's a good pool to draw from of people who care, people who want to tell stories in their community and inform. So right. I think it's pretty strong in a industry that's rough in general.
Yeah. Let me ask you another question, Ryan and Leota. I'd like you to pick up on this as well. All businesses rise or fall on this simple thing. You're either growing or you're shrinking. And I guess I'm curious, starting with you, Ryan, how do we grow more readers of independent news sites? That seems to be the biggest challenge here, and get people to stop defaulting to the bigger publications automatically.
Awareness is probably key. Mm-hmm. I think there are a number of independent publications, and they don't necessarily have the visibility that some of the larger outlets have. And you know, a lot of people probably don't know that there are targeted publications like Downtown Albuquerque News that they can even go to. So getting that word out is tough. And you know, for those outlets, how to do that? Advertising costs a lot of money. That's going to be a huge chunk of an investment for anyone running an independent outlet. So you know, other ways of getting it out there, social media, word of mouth. Yeah, I think those can help a lot of outlets.
Mm-hmm. Leota, I'm sure you're fighting this battle every morning you wake up. How do I get more readers that can make my numbers better, that advertisers can then respond to? How does an independent do that, attract more readers on a regular basis?
I think the main thing is to be relevant. You know, you got to be covering the things that people want to know about, or the things that they don't know that they want to know about.
Right.
I had a conversation with my grandson a couple of days ago. He's going to turn 16 in a few weeks. And I was trying to point him towards something that we had put in the Independent. And he was going, you know. And so I asked him, well, you know, what do you want to do to stay informed? And how, if you want to find out something going on, you know, what do you do? And he said, oh, I just Google it. And I said, well, okay, great. But what if the hit that you get is a newspaper? Because he was like, I just don't want to read newspapers. Don't want to read a newspaper. So I said, what if your Google hits a newspaper? He still doesn't want to read it. I know. How do you get around that kind of thing? I don't know. I mean, I think that's the holy grail in newspapers right now. When we figure that out, then we're all right. Gonna, you know, sleep easy.
Well, you make an interesting point there, not to cut you off, but it is a generational thing, part of the problem, isn't it? Younger people are just not in the habit of picking up a paper every day.
Yes. And so we do things like free distribution in the schools, and we try to put a lot of young people into the newspaper so that they have a reason to want to open the thing up.
Right.
So we try to put kids in, we try to put teenagers in, we've got the high school sports. And I also feel like that's a population whose voice is not heard enough in the pages of newspapers. And that's young people, kids, teenagers, early 20s, that kind of thing. So why would they pick up a newspaper if there's nothing relevant to them?